You probably want to sit here. Just tell people not to turn it off.
Oh, did they turn it off?
That's what happens, is when you turn it off, it goes through this cool down cycle.
I see.
And then that happens. Hour.
Oh, cool.
Now it goes through a warm up cycle.
It just has a weird shadow on it.
Oh, okay.
No, but it, I think it can fix this.
Okay. We good?
Freeze him. I suppose we can fix this. Because it
looks true for it.
Here. So I'm just going to be talking about Prolog, and in particular I'll just sort of introduce Prolog, introduce logic programming, and sort of go over a sketch of how you can implement part of it in Haskell. And then after that I'll talk a little bit about how the same ideas sort of come up when we do type inference and when we do type checking and when we use type classes. But first, with Prolog, and so in Prolog, the idea is that we're writing a program in a universe of atoms, where atoms are just sort of symbols which have themselves as a value. So they could be X, Y, and Z. But more interestingly, we can use them to talk about things we care about, like people, or fruit, or booleans, or anything, really. And you can think of these just like unary constructors in Haskell. So an atom is kind of like an enum, really. Except since Prolog isn't typed, there's no sealed boundaries, and anything at all could be an atom. As long as it's lowercase, so the cases are reversed in Prolog. Okay? And then the other thing we have are predicates, and these kind of tell us something about the world. And again, we probably want ones that actually tell us interesting things. Like, we can say that Bob likes pears, or that whatever is a noun, which I think it is. But that took some thought. And you can, in one way, think of these as non-unary constructors in Haskell. So, you know, saying noun whatever is kind of equivalent to constructing the value noun whatever from some algebraic data type. However, often it's better to think about these as actual predicates, where they're sort of a function from atoms to either true or false. So, sorry for the highlighting. This is a little bit messed up.
There's a way to change the aspect ratio on the projector.
Is there? Is the aspect ratio wrong, or?
Oh, I don't know. It was cut off on the edge, so I wonder if it, because when I did mine, it was.
Well, I think it might also be the fault of the resolution. We had some trouble setting it up.
Does this help?
Is that?
That's a different aspect.
Oh, right. Or can you, 16:9, can you do that?
How did that? That good?
Or well, I think if you did 69.
Yeah, I think that's good time.
Oh, okay. Sure. I mean, the other thing I can just do is make the window a little smaller and see if that helps a bit.
Or
maybe not. Is that kind of easier to see?
Yeah.
All right. So hopefully things don't overlap too much. And then, right, so a whole program sort of represents the entire universe. So a program is just a database of things we know. So we might know that Alice likes pears, and that Bob also likes pears, and any number of predicates like this. So this is what a Prolog file would look like. And so when you run your program, you load this up, and now you sort of have some amount of stored symbolic knowledge. And the idea is that we can interact with this stored knowledge by running queries. We can ask the Prolog interpreter if some predicate actually holds. And it will tell us. Which. And one interesting thing to note is that atoms aren't scoped at all. So if we ask something about an atom which we've never defined, it'll just tell us no. It won't give us an error or anything. So it kind of assumes a whole world out there. And if it doesn't know something, like, it can't differentiate about something that doesn't exist and something it doesn't know about. Okay, so the next thing we have are variables, which are written with capital letters. And these are quite useful when we're running a query, because we can ask, like, what does Alice like? And here we just have a variable fruit. And then the Prolog engine will go through the database and solve for which atoms could be substituted for the variable such that the whole predicate evaluates to true. So it will tell us that it could be a pear or that it could be an orange. And part of the trick is it does it lazily because there could be a lot of answers and we might only want some subset of them. And then, of course, if we ask a query about something that can't be satisfied at all, it will just tell us no. And this is where a lot of the jokes about Prolog come from, because basically when you mess something up or you have an error, it'll just tell you no repeatedly, which makes for an interesting interaction experience. I think as somebody described it, was that the person who made Prolog set out to write a language with the intelligence of a 2-year-old and succeeded by having to respond no to every query. And you really think about the way these variables work, just like pattern matching in Haskell. And in fact, to some extent, you can think about the whole Prolog program as a large list comprehension running against the universe. And here, for example, our query was likes Alice X. So we can actually write this in Haskell. And assuming the universe is some list that corresponds to all the knowledge in the Prolog program, this would actually behave like the simple query I showed. Now, this metaphor doesn't generalize all the way to sort of the full semantics of Prolog, but I think it gives you a good way to think about it in terms of things we can do with lists in Haskell. And it's especially apt because Haskell lists are lazy, so we actually get a lot of the same behavior without having to solve and search through everything. Right, and we can also use variables in the actual rule. So in our body of knowledge, we can have variables. And if you think about it, when you run a query against a variable, you're really asking, does there exist an X such that this is true? So when we asked, what does Alice like? We asked, is there some fruit that Alice likes? But when you have a variable in the body of knowledge, in the database, it's universal. So here, this fact is claiming that Charles likes everything. Right? And so if you ask, does Charles like apples? The answer is yes. And then if you ask, well, what does Charles like? Well, the answer is E likes anything, so we just created a new variable and gave it to you. I think sort of more sophisticated Prolog interpreters make this look a little bit prettier, but mine just sort of exposes the fact that it just made up a variable and thrust it at you. Now, one cute little aside, which will come up later, is that maybe you recognize this sort of style of variable where we just come up with a name and append a bunch of numbers to it. Because when you're using GHC and you're using type inference, type variables also often are just sort of invented out of thin air. And actually, this is kind of a somewhat similar process. And so one really neat thing is just with this amount of Prolog, we can already define equality. So equality doesn't have to be built into the language. We can actually just leverage the pattern matching to define a universal equality predicate. And we can just do it by saying that x is equal to itself. So for all x, x equals x. And this is enough to do any sort of equality queries we like. And in fact, as I mentioned, atoms aren't scoped. So in this case, since x is universal, we can actually ask about equality of things we don't know about. And so we've never mentioned foo anywhere before. And yet, equality would still be able to figure out that it works. Okay, so let me just move it over a bit. I mean, really, that's just sort of repeating, adding a few new rules to our database. We're just going to claim that these things are fruit. And so the problem we had earlier was that Charles liked everything. But really, we only want to talk about the fruits Charles likes. So we want to be able to write a rule that says Charles likes anything as long as that is a fruit. And that's exactly what this construction does. It lets us put constraints on the right-hand side of the equation. And so really, we can think of this just like implication. So we say that if x is a fruit, so x being a fruit implies that Charles likes it, right? And ultimately, the entire Prolog program is just going to be a large set of these implications, which is where the idea of logic programming comes from. And then by using these sort of implications as constraints and solving for the variables, we can write all sorts of interesting programs. But this is sort of the fundamental execution model, or I guess the main idea of the paradigm is to start with logical constraints and then do actual computation by finding things which satisfy those constraints. And so, in fact, if we add this, it would just find everything that is a fruit. And we also combine constraints with a comma as and. So here we're saying that Dan likes anything that is both a fruit and yellow, assuming yellow is defined somewhere. And we can also have or. So we can say that Eve likes anything that is a fruit, or anything that is a vegetable. And one way to do this is just sort of to write two separate cases. But there's also just often a little bit of syntax sugar with a semicolon. But fundamentally, we're just saying that there's two different kinds of conditions we can satisfy to solve for this particular predicate. So now let's just look at a couple of small examples. So this is a way to inductively define numbers. So we say that 0 is a number, and then we say that n is a number if n is equal to the successor of x, and x is a number. And this is kind of the familiar p-arithmetic sort of definition, although it's a little bit inelegant because we have this eq term, which doesn't really contribute to anything. But you know, and in fact, Prolog allows a little bit of syntax sugar to overcome this, where we could just write nested expressions, so nested patterns. And again, if you're familiar with Haskell pattern matching, this sort of follows the same principle in how you can nest patterns. And moreover, this is actually pretty similar to how we could define natural numbers in Haskell. And coincidentally, as a side note, you can actually use Unicode like this. So this is perfectly valid Haskell. So you could define a type that actually looks like the natural numbers. And also, interestingly, I mean, this also looks very similar to how we could define numbers at the type level. And so while at the value level in Haskell, we usually don't, use natural numbers that are, you know, unitary in base, because they're sort of exponentially worse than normal numbers, and people don't like that, which, you know, odd. But at the type level, since it's in compile time, and since we don't really have much capability, we actually often do use numbers that look like this. And while you can come up with binary numbers at the type level, if you really want to, it's a real pain. Whereas this is pretty straightforward. Okay, and another thing we could look at is how to do lists in Prolog. And again, it's just, this is a good example again of sort of recursive rules, which I should probably talk about, because recursive rules are the ones that really make Prolog sufficiently expressive to do arbitrary computation. This is kind of the place that Turing completeness sneaks in, because recursion lets you define sort of arbitrary loops. And in this case, we just define conditions that can be satisfied in an infinite number of ways. Right, and so for lists, there's also just a bit of syntax sugar, which I think might be sort of